Coming up,
this is certainly male pattern hair loss.
Hair loss affects everyone in some form or another at some point in their lives. But hair surgeon Dr. Bauman shares what we can do with or without surgery to look after those locks. This is Team USA weightlifter Alejandro Medina, and he'll school us on the sport of weightlifting. Those are some fresh berries, and I'll show you how to keep them fresher longer with some simple steps. All that and more is today on SoFlo Health. Welcome to SoFlo Health. I'm Hunter Frankie, and when you're in the gym, you're probably not weightlifting. It is very likely that you're lifting weights, but you're not weightlifting. If you're confused, don't worry. I'm here with Alejandro Medina, who is a professional weightlifter. Alejandro, what's weightlifting?
In the simplest way put, it is lifting the bar from floor to overhead in two different movements, one of them being directly from floor to overhead in one movement, and the second one being from floor to your chest, and then getting it from your chest to overhead.
So this is actually a sport?
Yes. I believe the only strength sport in the Olympics.
So when you're referring to weightlifting, it's not powerlifting, it's not CrossFit, it's not bodybuilding?
Correct. It is Olympic-style weightlifting, but I do believe the term weightlifting does belong to the sport of Olympic weightlifting.
Okay, cool. And this is comprised of basically two lifts, yeah?
Two lifts.
And what are they called?
The snatch and the clean and jerk.
All right, well, in just a minute, we're going to do the snatch and clean and jerk. In fact, I'm not going to do it, but Alejandro is going to do it to show you how it's done, and then we'll continue on and educate you about weightlifting. Your hair isn't just an expression of your style, it's also an expression of your health. We're here at Bauman Medical, where we came about 4 years ago now to find out what was causing your hair to fall out during COVID. Well, if your hair is still falling out, I still wanna know what's causing your hair to be going away or thinning or whatever you wanna call it. There's a lot of technology out there, supplements, medications, and I just wanted to get some answers. So we're here to see Dr. Bauman. Let's go see him. As promised, this is Dr. Bauman. Dr. Bauman, good to see you again.
Hey, great to see you, Hunter.
It's been quite some time, and a lot has changed in the hair restoration world.
We're in a fast-moving field, for sure.
Yes. So we'll start with the basics. Who does this affect the most?
So hair loss affects both men and women. There are almost 100 million American men and women out there who are suffering from hair thinning, hair loss, or scalp health issues.
What can we do about it? And is there anything we can do besides surgery even?
Well, there's a lot we can do. First of all, if you're starting to see the signs of hair loss, whether it's thinning in the crown area, receding hairline, if your ponytail's getting smaller, thinner, you're seeing more scalp shining through, you've got to get a diagnosis. You really need to see a board certified hair restoration physician to get an evaluation. Once you know what's going on, then therapies include non-surgical treatment options. So there's nutritional supplementation, the correct type of hair care. There may be non-chemical treatments like laser light therapy that you can use at home to help regrow hair. Medications to stop the progression of the hair loss. If you have hereditary hair loss, for example, medications work very, very well. For example, for male pattern hair loss.
We're gonna see more about how you approach that besides the surgery. However, we're in a room right now where you're doing surgery on a regular basis. When it comes to that, what kind of results can people expect?
So hair transplants have kind of gotten a bad rap over many, many years. People think that they're pluggy, they're painful, why would you ever do that, that they leave a linear scar. All of that are hair transplants from the days of old. So this is not your father's or your grandfather's hair transplant anymore. Today we're working with literally single follicle implants, individual follicular units that are extracted from the back of the scalp, so there's no linear scar left behind, there's no strip excision, there's no stitches or staples. It's not a painful process. You're gonna have local anesthetic. It's gonna be a comfortable day. It's not a fast process.
Yes.
It takes some time.
It comes to my attention that it almost seems that you're trying not to do surgery if you don't have to, and that you want to be able to save the hair before it goes away in the first place, if you can.
Well, prevention, right? An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, as they say, and it's much easier to protect and save the hair follicles before they're dead and gone, as opposed to needing a hair transplant to restore those hairs.
Great. So what are we going to see in just a bit?
So you're going to see where we do our evaluations. Mm-hmm. You'll see my AI-powered microscope, where we can literally count the hairs and quantify how much hair you have and what kind of hair you have in each zone. Then you'll see different procedure rooms, so where we do some of our regenerative treatments. You'll see the hair transplant process start to finish.
Well, I'm excited to take a look. Stay with me and with Dr. Bauman. We'll see you after you watch this.
Come right back for more weightlifting and non-surgical solutions to hair restoration after the break on SoFlo Health.
Focusing on you. Innovations in modern medicine from your team of experts at UHealth, the University of Miami Health System.
Millions of Americans suffer from some level of hearing loss, and many never seek help, says Dr. Hillary Snapp, chief of audiology at the University of Miami Ear Institute.
Individuals with hearing loss may not readily recognize that they're experiencing a hearing loss. People will ask often to repeat or turn up the volume of sound.
And as it progresses, people may stop going to places they once enjoyed, like out to restaurants and social gatherings.
Some of the psychosocial impacts of hearing loss are withdrawal, social isolation, depression, anxiety. Hearing loss has also been associated with an increased risk of cognitive decline.
I'm inside the Auditory Spatial Perception Lab at the University of Miami Ear Institute. Here they study a patient's ability to understand speech and background noise and to determine where sound is coming from.
What is your real-world lived experience with hearing loss? So it's a really exciting time to be working in this space. Technology is advancing. We are involved in a number of clinical trials for hearing devices and hearing and implants, as well as other therapeutics.
Dr. Snapp says hearing health is key to overall health.
The sooner you come in and get your hearing checked, the sooner we can intervene with new, innovative, cutting-edge treatment options, which will only serve to improve your quality of life.
Welcome back to SoFlo Health. I'm Hunter Frankie. This is Alejandro Medina, and he is a professional weightlifter, and you're about to see the snatch. Believe it or not, this isn't what we would call Alejandro's working weight. He's building up to that. And while you do, what should we look for? What is the purpose of the snatch? What is the technical part of it?
In competition, you're gonna get three attempts. And what determines a good lift is the elbows have to be completely straight, bar from forward to overhead, lock out the elbows, you cannot rebend, stabilize the weight, and wait for the down signal, and drop it in front. If you drop the bar behind, it's a no lift. If you come off the platform, it's a no lift.
All right, well, catch your breath. Yeah. We'll see him work up to his working weight. Earlier, we were with Dr. Bauman here at Bauman Medical, and we talked about hair loss, and now we're gonna show you what some hair loss looks like. So, Dr. Bauman, what do we have here?
Yeah, so we've taken photos of your scalp in several different areas. Some of the areas that we expect to see really good hair, the more permanent zones, and then some of the areas where you've seen some thinning.
Sure.
And we've uploaded those to the system. The AI-powered microscope, which is called Hair Metrics, counts the hairs and also quantifies the hairs, meaning it evaluates the thickness of each and every individual hair. So for example, the back of the scalp is supposed to have the highest density, the highest quality hair. You definitely have the highest quality hair in that zone. You see these numbers here show you 70s. So that's 73 microns. That's the average thickness of the hairs in the back of the scalp. And those are the hairs that are immune to male pattern hair loss. But if we look at the hairline, we see that your hair caliber is down in the 40s. This is certainly male pattern hair loss. We see a little bit of thinning in the temple areas. That's the area that's high risk. You do have, maybe have some hair loss in the family. So we want to be concerned about what's how do we protect this area.
Okay, great. And now we're going to go take a look at some of the other things that you do here to help prevent people losing their hair. Right?
Absolutely.
So follow us. I'm not entirely sure what's happening. So Doc, what is this?
So that's a Bauman Turbo laser cap.
Okay.
Low-level laser therapy is a non-chemical, non-invasive way to grow more hair.
This is just one way that you can address hair loss, because as we took a look at my hair and we had our discussion earlier, you said that I've got some male pattern baldness. So is that just something that's genetic? Can I do anything to improve it? Can I do anything to make it worse?
Male pattern hair loss is 100% genetic. Mm-hmm. The thinning that you're seeing in the hairline mm-hmm. and in the temple zones could continue further into the crown area.
Sure.
But the hair around the sides and the back is permanent.
I want to take a break from this here, not to distract our viewers. What is the hair homework that we can do?
The right shampoos, the right frequency of shampooing and hair care is really important. Taking care of any kind of inflammation, itching, flaking, dryness, or oily scalp.
And then what else do you have as you kind of move up here?
Yeah, the next level up, we got to feed the follicle, right? Because the hair follicles are some of the most highly metabolic cell population in your entire body. So your hair is made out of protein. That's what the hair follicle makes, is this protein fiber that you see and you feel and you style. Mm-hmm. So you need to make sure that you're adequately fed, that you have the right caloric intake, and that you're eating enough protein. There's also minerals, nutrients, vitamins, and things like that in this category. As we go up, the power and the strength really kicks in
sure.
terms of prescription medications.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are maybe most familiar with two things. That would be hair surgery, and then next level is this. They've probably heard of finasteride or minoxidil, famously, you know, famous brand names that I'm not gonna mention right now, but I think that they maybe aren't as aware of some of the other options that you have here, including the laser light therapy, which I think is pretty cool.
Right, so laser is in that non-chemical hair homework category. You're gonna use that at home for hair growth.
Got it. And if people at home right now are wondering, how can I learn more about this, how can they?
Well, the best thing they can do is go to BaumanMedical.com. We've got thousands of pages of information there.
Yes, and the facility is beautiful, state of the art, and we've learned a lot here today. I'm sure we're gonna have some more questions for Dr. Bauman. We'll pepper into some future episodes of SoFlo Health, but Dr. Bauman, thank you so much.
Thanks so much.
You got it. Pickleball enthusiasts and weekend warriors, listen up. We're back at Mount Sinai Medical Center to speak with Dr. Sharma and Dr. Vance from the Department of Orthopedics to find out more about different injuries and if they require surgery or not. So, let's meet the doctors. Who are you seeing in your practice every day? What sort of injuries are you treating and who has them?
Really, we're seeing any patient with a musculoskeletal injury. Mm-hmm. That's injury of the muscle, bones, tendons. These are our weekend warriors, our athletes.
As a non-operative physician, you know, I'm seeing patients, again, as she mentioned, weekend warriors, people who are avid pickleball players, tennis players, even just your day-to-day person who has an injury, who can't go to work. And we can manage things from getting into physical therapy to providing pain management. So if I see a patient who perhaps maybe has an ACL tear or has a meniscus tear or has a fracture that needs a surgical intervention, I pass that along to Dr. Vance.
And Dr. Vance, do you do the same thing? Sometimes people come in thinking, I swear I need surgery, and you say, well, maybe not yet.
Yeah, exactly. It's once we get the diagnosis, then we can work together to kind of shift the patient to either Dr. Sharma or myself.
When is it surgical, when is it not?
Fractures, hip fractures, certain long bone fractures. A lot of the injuries that we see can at least be initially treated with non-operative management. And then if that doesn't improve the injury or the pain, then we talk surgery.
Dr. Sharma, is there anything else that you would find that separates you from other orthopedics out there?
We all are eager to get our patients back to the activities that they want to do, whether that's just their day-to-day activities and their work life, or getting them back to playing pickleball or swimming or traveling or being able to enjoy their life with their family. We have a hand and upper extremity expert. We have a joint replacement expert. We have a foot and ankle expert. So we have a multitude of subspecialties within our department.
Orthopedic injuries kind of fall in two big groups. So if you fell, if you have an acute injury, you should see someone immediately for that. The ones that are more the chronic overuse injury, you have a little more leeway to do the rice, you know, the rest, the ice, elevation, and then come see us if it doesn't get better.
Excellent. And if people would like to learn more about what it is you guys are doing on a regular basis, how can they?
Yeah, they can check out our website or they can call our office and schedule an appointment and we can get you in fairly quickly.
Great. Dr. Sharma, Dr. Vance, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
You got it.
Keep your berries fresh in the refrigerator for longer with this trick when SoFlo Health returns.
This is Alejandro Medina. He's a professional weightlifter that's been with us today. Welcome back to SoFlo Health. I'm Hunter Frankie. We saw the snatch earlier, which looks like this. And now we're moving on to the clean and jerk. So what should we be looking for as we watch you do the clean and jerk?
So much like the snatch, you're going from floor to overhead. However, for this one, you're gonna be breaking it up into two movements. So from floor up to your chest, and then you're gonna dip and drive it up over your head.
For the sport, what are they looking for as a qualifier or disqualifier?
So, same thing with the snatch, the elbows can't bend. The clean and jerk has a few more. Well, I guess the snatch has it as well. One I didn't mention was your butt cannot touch the floor, mm-hmm. which actually happens, believe it or not. So from being like hypermobile, so you cannot bottom out, your butt cannot touch the floor. And then for the clean, when you're doing the rack portion, your elbows cannot touch your knees. So those will disqualify you, and then as well as the elbows cannot be bent as well, just like the snatch. So those two things as well with the elbows, and then the same rules apply. You have to drop it out in front. You have to stabilize, recover your feet, and then drop it onto the platform.
Great, let's see it. I'm now joined by Uberto of Healthy Longevity Clinic. He's the CEO. Uberto, thanks for having us.
Thank you very much for inviting me, and I'm thrilled to be here and talk about this project.
What is the clinic all about?
Adding healthy years to your life. I don't want to say longer life because we don't know when we're going to die. I can tell from my own experience, you know, some people at 55, mm-hmm. they are filled with illnesses. They can't do many things. I feel younger than I used to be when I was 25.
So who is this for?
This is first for somebody that needs to be proactive. You know, we can find out what's going on. We can provide you with the latest in interventions. We can provide you with the latest in technology, but you have to take the action.
Is it like investing where we know that one of the most powerful forces on earth is compound interest? Is it the same thing with your health?
Totally. If you start walking 1 mile more, you know, it will compound into more healthy heart, more healthy lungs, more healthy legs. Changing few things will compound into so much afterwards.
Let's listen in to Dr. Levitt, your medical director, and yes. find out a little bit more about that.
Yes.
So I'm the medical director at Healthy Longevity Clinic. I basically manage people's health plan for the rest of their life. One of the main things that separates us is we do advanced diagnostic testing, we use AI technology, and we're doing extreme personalized healthcare medicine. Regular conventional allopathic medicine are typically interested in you once you get a disease. I don't want you to get cancer and then treat you. I want to figure out, are you predisposed to cancer? Is there a place where I can intervene in your immune system or your levels of inflammation in your body so that you don't develop a chronic disease? We can look at all of these areas in your health profile, and we can determine your risk factor, and then we can actually decide, okay, what changes? What's going on in your life that we can change, perhaps, whether it's diet or lifestyle? And then we're going to decide, where can we intervene on a personalized level? It's never too early and it's never too late to seek a longevity medicine professional or an anti-aging specialist.
Thank you, Dr. Levitt. There's so many tests you can do here. I did the InBody. I even found out how my arteries are functioning, and there's grip strength, so many different things.
It's meeting the patient where that patient is, because for some patients, they just want quick and they want the interventions right now. Others are like, no, let's take it easy. There are other interventions that are unique to what we do because of the partnership with the Longevity Technology Fund. You can't find it somewhere else, so it's a unique approach.
If people would like to learn more, how can they?
The easiest way is it's through the website. There's a lot of information there. We have, you know, a nice blog, and they can contact us.
Uberto, thank you so much.
No, thank you for the invitation.
You got it. Berry season is upon us, which means that the produce shelves are chock full of blueberries, strawberries, raspberries, blackberries. We'll help you keep them fresher for longer and hopefully get your best use out of them. And they'll be cleaner, which we like. We're gonna create our cleaning solution with distilled water and white vinegar. You do 3 parts water to 1 part vinegar. I'll start with these blueberries. We'll drop them in. All right, I'm gonna let those soak. After they've soaked for a bit, grab them out of this solution, drop them into your clean solution. All right, switch them to get that vinegar if there is any. off of them here. It's not just the soaking part of this. You've probably cleaned fruit or berries before, but the key is to get them dry before you store them. Got all my blueberries. All right, salad spinner top here. Get my little break here. Take the top off. And now you will see what is left. A lot of the water that would be a lot harder to dry off manually with just a towel. Storage is also an important part. So I've got a airtight container here with paper towel inside to help soak up any excess moisture. They should last in your fridge for at least a few days. Sometimes they will surprise you and last for about a week. Enjoy berry season. They're packed full of antioxidants. They're low carb. They're a great way to get that sweet tooth out of the way without getting a bunch of sugar, and should get some good usage out of your clean berries that taste great. Alejandro, how much weight is this?
375 pounds.
That's crazy. Welcome back to SoFlo Health. I'm Hunter Frankie. Alejandro here, a professional weightlifter, has been doing the clean and jerk with this weight, which is crazy to me. Earlier, we showed you the snatch as well, and those are the two lifts that make up the sport of weightlifting. Now, is this the only thing that you do to train?
So it's the primary thing, but obviously we do have a lot of accessories. The four things we do the most of are gonna be snatch, clean and jerk, the moves we did today, and then squatting and pulling, which is similar to like a deadlift.
For the sport itself, there's two lifts, but then you also, like everyone else, are still training to stay in good shape.
Probably less than someone else may, but still definitely doing them.
If we want to learn how to do this, how can we?
Well, I'm a coach as well as we have a few coaches here. You can reach out to me via my Instagram, which is Medina_Island, or you can go to the website directly, which is the3whitelights.com.
Well, Alejandro, thank you so much for showing off your skills with us today. If you like this, well, don't worry. On the next Health, we're going to learn how to do this. And when I say we, I mean me. So in fact, let's check out what's on the next SoFlo Health.
Dr. Sam Rasool is here to help you avoid or soothe those tight hamstrings, and it's time for me to give weightlifting a try with the supervision of Alejandro.
Speaking of what's up next, later on today, SoFlo Home Project host and design expert Elena Capra has a new episode of SoFlo Home Project. Elena, what's going on?
Hi, Hunter. So today we are talking about adding color to your home decor. Later today on SoFlo Home Project, we'll share with you the rules of applying color throughout the spaces of your home.
Thanks so much, Elena. That's all we have for this week's episode of SoFlo Health. If you want to catch up on previous episodes, you can do so on SoFloShows.com. You can also follow us using @SoFloHealth to share with us what you're doing to stay healthy. Until next week, it's goodbye, good health, and good luck to me lifting this. Well, not this. We're not going to lift. This is too much. I can't do that.